Good afternoon, everybody. Better than that, good afternoon. Okay. I think I'm probably the oldest person in the room, which is really a bummer because I used to be the youngest person in the room. No one here is older than the class of 75, right? No, I didn't think so. Okay. But that's the way it goes, okay? So one gets older like fine wine. But first of all, welcome back to UC Berkeley. And some of us are real chauvinists about this place, that we love this place. We love it much, much more. We are convinced that our friends love the place down, we call it our friends down the road. This is the place where lives change, actually. And this is the only brand name business school that I know of that has a leadership communications requirement. Everyone else can actually, oh, would you like to do a little bit of leadership? Maybe that would be nice. Or maybe it would be nice if you were a communicator. Or, you know, let's make it free choice. Or I think our friends down the road have a class called touchy-feely, if you feel like it. Or something, you know, those kinds of things. We're not into touchy-feely at Berkeley, even though, you know, one says, you know, I left my beads at home and all those kinds of things, despite Berkeley's reputation. This is actually very much coming out of our dean's idea, and Rich Lyons is a real, real hero for me, because on many, many levels. But I don't know many deans who walk their talk when they're talking about confidence without attitude. He means it. Students always, he means it. Beyond yourself, that's the law of the land. And challenge the status quo. Don't just sit there. Ask the smart question. And when you really begin to put that in the mix with a leadership communications requirement, at a brand name business school, and by the way, the evening weekend MBA program just happens to be in first place, once again, according to The Economist and US News. How did that happen? Those kinds of things. Because you have a dean who actually isn't frightened of the crowd. He basically stands tall with courage. And actually stands behind his principles. And very, very frankly, it's one of the students' favorite classes. They come to it, oh God, I don't want to do this. And finally, it's a class about them. It's a class about how good of a communicator are you? Are you an inspiring leader? Are you somebody who's a powerful communicator? Or are you another boring face in front of the room? That's going to actually put people to sleep, death by PowerPoint? Or are we going to have to pass out the no-dos once you get up there? Or are we going to have some color and some pizzazz and all those kinds of things? So what Doy and I want to do, and Doy and I and a bunch of other folks have the great privilege of working with over 250 great, great students every year in actually making them into inspiring communicators. And one says, oh, I suppose you have to be born that way. No, you don't. Yeah, there are a few good athletes. Should the rest of us not play baseball? A few good people who can kind of, you know, play tennis. The rest of us don't play tennis. I mean, it's crazy. We can all learn. Oh, I'm an introvert. Good. I'm an engineer. Bravo. 92% of my practice is engineers. Thank God for engineers. That's not a problem. We can learn any skill that we want to. And what I love about Berkeley is this is a place of non-judgment. You want to learn it, we'll work with you, and we throw away our watches. You want to come for extra lessons, we'll work with you. We'll make it happen. So this is an interactive workshop. I'm not going to say all that much, because this is all about the leader as storyteller. The leader as communicator. And it's all about human connection. I promise you right now in this room of God knows how many, 100, 150 of you, there are such phenomenal stories, powerful life stories of how you became the leaders you became. Each of you has, by the way, I'll tell you right now so I can fast forward the 50-hour class into 1 hour. Each of you has about 50, 60 stories. You may say, I don't even have one. That's not true. You have 50, 60 moments that have made you the leader that you are. And many of them are actually valuable and important for other people to actually hear and find out, because they can actually be a source of inspiration to those people too. So that's what's really important. So just turn to your neighbor. You may know them, you may not know them, and I'd like you to shake hands and get to know each other in a moment. Okay? But I'd also like you just to brainstorm real quickly. 60 seconds. One of the things that we look at in leadership communications, thank God, Harvard Business Review finally told the truth after all these years of reading these bloody articles. They said, there's no such thing as a recipe for leadership. Hallelujah. There's no such thing as a recipe for leadership. Jack Welch, great guy. Steve Jobs, may his soul rest in peace, great guy. Interesting guy, controversial guy. But the point is, stop imitating other people. Be you and draw from the best of the best. And you become your own authentic leader. So at Berkeley, what we really value in our MBA programs is to become an authentic leader that works for the people that you're working with. So just brainstorm with your partner, anyone you can find, the best looking person you can find sitting next to you, on your left or your right, above you, beside you. What are the best practices that you think make an authentic leader? 60 seconds, shake hands, ready, go. Best practices, and keep eating. So already you see lesson one. Look at the famine, look at how much people want to connect. There's so much to talk about. When did you last have a really good conversation? The art of conversation is gone. Okay? You're going to have a chance to absolutely connect. This whole hour is about human connection. You know more than I know already about the human story. The human story is never boring. The human story is never boring, and you're going to hear some great, great stories in this room in about 15 minutes. So let me just hear a few, just shout them out, just a few best practices. Best practices of being an authentic leader. What do you think an authentic leader takes on as an authentic leader in terms of a best practice? Can I hear three or four? Yeah.
Show empathy.
Sorry?
Show empathy.
What's your definition of empathy?
Understanding how the other person is feeling.
Yeah. Understanding how the other person's feeling. So in other words, expression of empathy, really, really walking in the other person's shoes. But not a t-shirt, not a poster. Forget about these posters and these things. I want to see you walk your talk. I want to see it in real life. And part of the work that we do here, and the reason we split up leadership communications, this might be empathy, this might be emotional intelligence. Now go back to your workplace, everybody, and do this, and try this out, and come back and report your successes and failures in a few weeks, and tell me what really happened when you tried out some of these things. Give me three more.
Engagement. You must get them emotionally and psychologically involved.
Sorry?
You must get your subjects emotionally and psychologically involved.
Great. Okay, super. Give them a big, big hand. That's great. Okay. Good. Let me hear two or three more. Yeah.
I think you've got to genuinely care about the people you're leading and the direction you're leading them in.
Genuinely care about the people that you're leading. Genuinely care, and that also means really getting to know people, to really, really get to know them, to know where they're coming from. Give me a couple more. Yep.
Listening more than dictating.
Listening more than dictating. Very nice.
So we talked about having a vision and being able to sell that vision.
Vision and being able to sell that vision. Nice. Come on.
Awareness. Both externally aware, but self-aware.
Awareness, both externally and self-aware. And I just want to talk about that just for a moment. That's actually one of the most important things and one of the most important practices for an authentic leader. The practice, the lifelong practice of self-awareness. In other words, and self-knowledge, to really be working on yourself on an ongoing basis if you choose to lead people, because leadership is finally the act of service. So after each meeting, after each phone call, after each interaction, what worked, what needed work, not beating yourself up, but how can I do better? Not simply being complacent and blowing things off that was just the best I could do. No, it wasn't. In other words, to really stay in the game and to really see how I can make that better. Give me two more and we're done. Sir?
Set priorities.
Set priorities. Very, very nice.
Lead by example.
Lead by example. Very, very good. And a big one is a lot of this for a lot of companies, because don't forget the Silicon Valley and big companies are right in our backyard. A big, big part of it is, are you living the values? What's all this business about values if you're not going to live the values? There the values are in black and white. What are these values there for? To kind of tick the report card? What does it look like to actually role model those values, live those values? And that's when you really begin to get authentic leaders who are truly role modeling values so that their people can actually feel a sense of respect. It's so interesting when you sit in on a lot of the exit interviews. I've sat in on hundreds of them. And it is rarely, I'm leaving ABC company, rarely. It is usually, I'm leaving Jack because Jack doesn't care about us and doesn't care about the group. I basically am getting nowhere in this company. I've spoken about my career and I might as well be speaking to the wall. People do not leave companies, they leave managers. That's just the way it is. I have all the data that I can actually show you. So just keep that in mind. A couple more you may want to consider. So it's living the values. It's empowering people, knowing there are going to be some errors along the way. But you don't have to let Johnny fall off the bike and crack his head. He falls off the bike. He should be wearing a helmet, by the way. Falls off the bike, help him get back on, and you help him ride the bike better. It's called the leader's coach. It's called the leader's coach. It's called the leader's teacher. It's called the leader in the act of service. And I feel the same way about leaders as I do about teachers. If you're too damn busy to work with your people, move over, Daddy. Move over, Beethoven. There's plenty of jobs as independent contributors, or open a hot dog stand. It's more honest. There's a great job in the Guam Lighthouse. You don't have to talk to anybody. You just have to direct the ships. But if you choose to be a leader, and this is the mantra at Berkeley, you have chosen the act of service. I don't care that you happen to be in the right place at the right time, and your mortgage is of no interest to me. We're all paying the mortgage. We're all paying the bills. But don't commit the act against nature, which is you are in charge of lives. And I really go wild about this, you know, being a father in schools and grandfather in schools. You don't want to correct the kids' papers? Get the hell out of Dodge, man. There are plenty of people who do want to correct the kids' papers. Plenty of people who do want to spend time with the kids. Plenty of people who aren't watching the clock, who in fact will give to the kids. So that's the whole thing with leadership. And just to conclude this, the leadership story, your leadership stories, are pearls of wisdom for other people. You've walked the path already. You've had success, you've had failures. You have failed, I have failed. That doesn't make you a bad person. People can learn through my failures. I'm not embarrassed about my failure. I'm a human being. And when you have the guts to share some of those things which didn't work out so well, I can actually inspire other people to do better. I just want to just show real quickly my five powers here. This is very, very much what we're teaching, the guideline for telling the compelling story, which I'll be working with you on, and Dory's going to give you a good warm-up for this as we actually tell our, you know, stories. I'll come to the top one here. But if we take a look here, the power of communication. The third one, we're really talking about language, and this is very much what we're doing at Berkeley. We're saying, are you speaking language or the language speaking you? There's a hell of a lot of corporate speak. You know, the IRD or the DYB. I mean, what is this stuff. Speak language, please. Speak language. Strong, deep, and brief language. When the guys get into 200C, they're gorgeous looking, perfect faces, everything, but they use too many words. Too many words. Get it deep and brief, baby. You get a minute. You know, that's why we pay $5 million for a commercial, because you got to get it done in 60 seconds. Same deal here. Power of conviction. What is your belief system? What's your belief system? If you're going to tell a story, what do you believe? If you're going to make a business passion presentation, what is your belief system? Martin Luther King didn't say, I have a dream, I wonder if they're up to it. Come on, you have to have an actual belief. Your knowledge, you have to do your homework. The intention, what do you want to leave your audience with? And then finally, the power of presence. I want to just ask you this as a question. What do you think presence is? What do you think presence is, folks? Presence, yes, ma'am. Sorry?
Charisma.
Beautiful. What's your name?
Laura.
Were you my student?
No.
You should have been. Okay, exactly right. Charisma, good. Who do you know that has presence that you admire? You're from Italy, right?
Yes. Bueno.
That's right. Who do you know that has charisma? Anyone?
Not
Who? Okay. Who do you know, guys, that has charisma?
Obama.
Mandela. Okay. So the idea of presence, and to think about presence, and whether you like him or hate him, I'll tell you, when Bill Clinton came on TV the other night, I just loved it when he said, I don't know what the big, big problem is. He says, because if you vote for my wife, basically you're getting two for the price of one, and this time I'm not charging. We loved him. You can hear the crowd shouting 4 more years already. You can't help but love him. The blue eyes are shining. He's back home, you know? So, presence, if we just put the slide on here. This is what we're teaching around storytelling. Leadership presence is the skill set that allows leaders to motivate, inspire, and connect to the thoughts of your audience, really. To motivate, inspire, it's your voice. It's your body. It's your thoughts. It's the way you tell that story. Okay? So we're going to do a little deal with you around leadership presence. Leadership presence. And just know that a story, a powerful story from your own life, is that made you the leader that you are, is a gift to your audience. If it's the right story at the right time, it's a gift to your audience, because it will cause learning. It will cause self-reflection. It will cause all sorts of things. Real quickly, I had a guy head of the national lab, one of the labs I was working with, because, you know, we work with all these different companies. And he could have had a no confidence vote at any moment. And I said to him, we're going to have a big leadership seminar. Jackie, why don't you at least start off with a story? He said, I don't have any leadership stories. I said, well, then I think we're done with our coaching relationship, because nobody in the lab likes you, trusts you, or I said, I'm done. He says, you mean you're firing me as your coachee? I said, that's about the way it goes. I don't have any more work to do. Nobody believes in you. He says, okay, if it makes you happy. I said, don't make me happy. Don't go to that level. Do me a real favor. He said, okay, I'll tell a leadership story. So the night comes. And I like, know he's going to say something dumb. And he goes, he says, Mark wants me to tell. I said, don't you do that. He said, okay, I'd like to share my leadership story. It's very short. But I do have a small leadership story that tells you a little bit about my background. He comes out. There are like 500 engineers all sitting there, National Laboratory. And he comes forward, man about 60, and he says as follows. He says, my father died when I was 6. My father died when I was 6. My mother, after her day job, had to put on a maid's uniform. and go out and scrub the floors of the rich people in South Miami Beach, so my five brothers and myself would have food to eat on the weekends. My mother will be 93 next Thursday. She remains my most beloved hero. What do you think the engineers did? What do you think happened? It was like a rock concert. I see people high-fiving. I couldn't believe it. And the next day at the lab, I couldn't believe the atmosphere. And I'm listening to the conversations. They said, okay, we get it, we get it. I said, what do you get? They said, well, look, you know, you come from that background. You kind of hard to spend money. And then I went to his office, and he says, wow, that was quite a night. I said, yeah, it really, really was. He says, you know, I feel like a load's off my shoulders. I said, I bet you do. So you see, even telling the story, things can shift. Just that little story, things shifted. And there was already, from that little story, a human understanding of a man coming from poverty that hadn't been able to share that. Suddenly there was understanding among so many people from literally 30 seconds in front of them. That's what I mean about the power of story. Okay, Dory.
Thanks, Mark. So I'm going to get you guys to do an exercise quickly before we get into the storytelling work here. But to set the stage for what we do in leadership communication, I want you to think about this. My own experience, I learned back when I was a manager that oftentimes when a manager or a leader communicates something to their team, how it's communicated, your intentions could be totally misinterpreted. So for example, you take the word okay, right? Somebody sends a quick email to ask for a question, and I write back, okay, two words, two letters. Then I realize that when people read that, sometimes they read it as okay. Sometimes it's okay. Sometimes it's okay. And if they have a very vivid imagination, then they start imagining what I'm doing with my face and my body too. Sometimes it's okay. 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 Now the reality is, what I learned from that is not to rely on just words. Because when you rely on just words, it opens up room for a whole bunch of interpretation here. Now, if you start adding the voice to it, this is through a phone call, for example, then now they start to hear the tone of voice, right? So they know that whether or not you're happy about it, you're mad about it or not. And even better, if you meet face to face, or these days we have all kinds of technology that allows us to see face to face, then, sometimes you don't even have to say it, and people already understand what your intentions are. So, in this next exercise, I want you to think about that. What does it really mean when we make a choice to use every single part of our communication that we can, words, voice, and nonverbal communication, to truly communicate your intention so that the audience can receive it exactly as you intended it to? Now, when we talk about voice, what are we talking about, right? Volume, pitch, sometimes it's high, sometimes it's low, sometimes it's really fast, sometimes you slow down and pause. And when we talk about nonverbal communication, we're talking about eye contact, facial expression, hand gestures, physical expression. Now, I'm going to give you words today, and you can't come to a Mark Rittenberg class without doing some exercise inspired by the theater world. So I'm giving you words from Shakespeare. Be not afeard, the isle is full of noises, sounds, and sweet airs that give delight and hurt not. Now these are just words right now. What I'm going to ask you to do is to channel the intention behind those words, okay? You guys are not to look so frightened. But first step, can we all just stand up, please? And get very comfortable. Mark promised an interactive workshop, so here we go. We're going to get very interactive.
You're going to get it.
Okay, so shake out your hand, your feet.
You
make sure you have room so you're not going to knock your neighbors over if you start to get active. All right, and don't block the slide, sir. Make sure. Okay, so first line, be not afeard. Now, I want you to channel this intention. The inner warrior, the fighter, courage, and really make people feel that there's nothing to be afraid of, okay? And it's all about your intention. So what do you have to do in your voice, and in your physical expression, face, eye contact, everything, to communicate to whoever it is that's receiving this message that there's nothing to be afraid of. Be not afeard, okay? So let me see how you do that without giving you too much tips. So already hands out of the pocket, there's no cross arms. And I want you to think full body. So use your whole presence. And I promise you, no one's looking at you because they're too worried about themselves. Okay? He's just a statue. Nobody. Okay, here we go. Be not afeard. 1, 2, 3.
Be not afeard.
Nice. I'm hearing some real courage there. Okay. So some of you guys are already at about 80%. Some of you are still 40%. But let's get that all the way up to 100%. Okay? And all our MBA students do this. So since you didn't get to take the class, now here's your chance.
Good voice warm up for you.
Oh yeah, here we go. Be not afeard and use your whole body. 1, 2, 3.
Be not afeard.
That's more like it. Okay, now let's try something. Get even bigger. So think using your hand, like fill up this space. Get really big. 1, 2, 3.
Be not afeard.
That's what I'm talking about. Good. Oh yeah, then you might get back in the chair in a moment. Next line, I want excitement, I want joy, jump out of your skin like, wow, this is awesome. The isle is full of noises, okay? So just channel this kind of excitement and joy. 1, 2, 3.
The isle is full of noises.
Yeah, pretty good, Haas. Here we go. Now, our voices, and when we talk about using your full range of voice, when we were younger, we use that whole range. You know, sometimes you get really excited, a voice goes up, and it's really up here. And then sometimes you get mad and disappointed, and the voice goes down. Now, all of a sudden, when we get older and become more mature, somehow we go through this evolution that your voice just starts to get really in a certain range. And this is as much as variation as I have in my voice, which is not true. So in storytelling, we're going to get back in touch with the full range of your voice. So in this line in particular, I want you to get connected with your higher register. And here's a little tip from an actor. Your voice goes where your body goes. So you go, ah, up. Your voice is going to go, ah, up too. So up, okay? I'm just going to give you that much clue. The isle is full of noises. High pitch. 1, 2, 3.
Great.
Here we go. Now go big or go home. If you don't have injury, I want you to even jump into the air. It'll feel good, I promise you. Oh, it's full of noises. 1, 2, 3. Yes, okay, now. This next line, we're gonna go to the other end of the emotion. Now we're gonna get deep. And I'm glad you like it. Mysterious and perhaps even a little seductive. This is where you get to practice your eye contact. Make good use of those eyes, okay? I'll just give you that much clue, and let's see if we're out of practice or not. Sounds and sweet airs. 1, 2, 3.
Sounds and sweet airs.
Not bad. Now, In addition to the pitch of the voice, vocal variety also includes the pace of it. Now, I want you to really eat up each of these words. Sounds and sweet airs, you know? Milk it for all it's worth. Here we go. 1, 2, 3.
Sounds and sweet airs.
Oh, yeah. And perhaps more seductive, less scary. Okay? So, that's why I said eye contact. There's a difference between scary eyes and come hither eyes. Okay, here we go. And don't be afraid to use the movement. So you can use your hips, let it flow. 1, 2, 3.
Sounds and sweet
airs. Yeah, some of you guys are a little out of practice, but that's okay. We'll come back to that. That give delight and hurt not. Hey, the storm's gone. Everything's going to be okay. And this is the kind of voice that, as leaders, you have to really be able to use well in times of uncertainty, people are unsure, for you to say, you know, we're going to be okay. That give delight and hurt not. And this is where you use your facial expression. How do you show somebody, it's going to be okay, not it's going to be okay? Smile, okay, here we go. 1, 2, 3. Yeah, and even think to a little child, it's going to be okay, little kid, that give delight and hurt not. 1, 2, 3. There we go. Okay, now let's do that again. That was warm-up round. Now we're going to do the four lines back to back to back, okay? And I want you guys to really, really, really channel that. And I want to see full body engagement. Some of you guys are still this, hands in the pocket. Nope, not going to do it. Let that go. And just for the next minute or so, I want you to use your full expression. Because it's like going to the gym. If you don't work on those muscle of communication, when you have to get up there and communicate something to somebody, and if that's the first time you're thinking about working on those muscle, it's too late. So here's a chance for you to get a little boot camp. Here we go. So I want big, 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 okay? 1, 2, 3.
We are here.
Not bad, okay.
Great.
All right, now, I'm gonna split the room in half, right here. So right side, left side, part to see. Okay, now you guys get to be the audience for a moment. This side of the room here, just kind of turn sideways, so face your audience, while you can still cheat and see the lines, okay? Now I'm gonna put the lines up here, four lines back to back. Now it's up to you to channel the intention. So, be not afraid, the eye is full, you know, do it your way, and you got an audience to work with now. So don't worry about me. Make some eye contact now, find your audience. And audience, don't avoid their eye contact, embrace them in to your, yeah, there we go. Okay, now, team A, ready, set, begin!
Be not afraid, the eye is full.
What do you think, audience?
Yeah.
Okay.
Great.
Pretty good. Okay, Team B. Now you guys' turn. You guys get to be the audience now. Enjoy. Make your eye contact. Find your audience.
All the way. Don't hold back.
Ready, set, go.
Yeah.
Okay, pretty good. Now, back together, back together. Now the director can watch you. Okay, so.
Full out, don't hold back, jump out of your skin.
Okay, and I want to see levels even more, right? Up here, and then sometimes it's down here.
Last time.
Use your whole body, okay, down. I'm gonna be watching for your eyes. Back there, sir, I can see you, so. Eye kind of, okay? 1, 2, 3.
Be not
yes! Bravo.
Well done.
Okay, have a seat. I think they're warm, Mark.
Okay, you're ready. Fantastic. Thank you so much. Okay. Final part. Final part. Now you're ready to jump into the leadership story. So what you're going to do is you're going to connect to the person. You're going to connect to the person next to you. You're going to have a short conversation, just about 5 or 6 minutes. Just start to get to know each other. And while you do that, I'd like you to share a leadership moment that's made you the leader you are. A leadership moment, a leadership event, a powerful moment that's made you the leader you are, that you feel comfortable sharing. And as I told you, you have many. You all became the leaders you became. You all got to Haas for some reason. You all graduated for some reason. You've all created these lives. What are the leadership moments? Might be from childhood. They may be very, very personal. And what is the powerful event or powerful moment that you choose to share with your partner that's made you the leader who you are? And then, this is very much from our leadership communications class, then on the level of my friend who talked about empathy and compassion, then what you're going to do, and we'll have time to hear just a few of these. So if Brenda was my partner, I then would come up with Brenda, and I would have 60 seconds to tell her story to all of you, and Brenda would tell my story to all of you. So I get to honor Brenda, and it's an honoring of another person. We're able to teach those skills too, those leadership skills. What does it mean to honor another person? Acknowledge another person? Appreciate another person? Yes, in the workplace, we use those words. Appreciate another person. Acknowledge another person. Because we have the studies to show that when you appreciate and acknowledge people in your brand name companies, and you know what they are, you work for them. Guess what? People stay. People say, if you just say a thank you once in a while, I'd probably stay another couple of years. I've heard thank you in years and no one cares if I'm here or not, I'm out of here. So the idea, what does it mean to honor Brenda by telling her story? And Brenda would tell Mark's story. And the way that we do it, I'm going to give you a really quick formula. Really quick formula. I'd like you to try to tell these stories with a vertical takeoff. What's a vertical takeoff? You guys are bright. What's a vertical takeoff? Come on, my grads. What's a vertical takeoff? So I'll tell you what it's not. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to present to you. That's not a vertical takeoff. What's a vertical takeoff? Yeah.
It's going straight into the thick of the story.
Give me one, Michelle. You can do it.
I'm so good.
Someone, give me a vertical takeoff.
On a dark and stormy night.
Do it, that's beautiful, man. Peter, come on, stand up and say it. And do it with all your body, go on.
On a dark and stormy night.
Even bigger, jump out of your skin, baby.
On a dark and stormy night.
Give him a hand, okay, that's good. On a dark and stormy night. Yeah. Or, and this is a true one. Suddenly I find myself on a raft on the Jordan River with a black South African woman named Tandi Masaweni. She leans over to me and she says, Mark, I forgot to tell you something. I said, what is it, sweetheart? She said, I forgot to tell you I can't swim. And boom, we're in the water. Okay. I said, well, why did you do that? Why did you do that? She says, because I knew you wouldn't let me come if I told you. And we got to the end of the river. And she turned to me with a big smile. She says, we beat the river, didn't we? I said, yes, I have heart failure, but we beat it. Okay, so vertical takeoff, clear beginning, middle, and end. You bring a curtain up, and you bring it down. That's your clear beginning. Keep it going in your ending. And Dory just did a beautiful job, the vocal variety. Give it expression. We don't do monotone. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm excited about the last quarter results. I said to my team, wow, We're sick of that stuff. And you know what? The people are sick of it too. Put in, I don't mean you're going to jump up and down, be not afeard. But I'm just saying, put in some vocal variety. So Doyle and I are going to give you a quick model. Then you guys are going to talk. So would you like to start? So we begin okay. with a curtain going up, which has become code at Berkeley. So if you come to Berkeley graduation, you will see my gorgeous kids all bring a curtain up in tribute to the old man. So I'm very, very happy, the class speaker. Okay.
Okay, so I'm going to need a lot of support. So when the curtain comes up, we show support for whoever's up here. I'll give you that much hint. Okay. Curtain up. Graduation day, Greek theater. As Mark stands on the stage, look out into the sea of students, bright shining faces in their graduation gown. He is excited. But in this moment, he's not up here to congratulate the students, but he is up here to accept the Chai Teaching Award for teaching excellence. And as he looked at all those faces looking back at him, those students who honored him by nominating him for this award, he couldn't help but feel joy and at the same time sadness that there are so many people who he wished were here today. All the teachers that he's had, his mom, and even his dear daughter, Anais, who's no longer with him. But what he has learned today and what he teaches all comes from those who have taught him so many things about love and life. And on that stage, as Mark is being honored by all of his students, he decided that his work is not done. And that the way he will honor all of those people who has meant so much to him is to continue sharing the message of love and life. Curtain down.
Wow. Curtain up. Summer, 1995, Bangkok Airport. A young boy is about to venture on his voyage to the United States. He's standing at the departure gate with his mother. She pulls out a dollar bill. She says, "Take this dollar bill, my son." He looks at it, he says, "Well, Mom, thank you, but that's not gonna buy very much where I'm going." And she says, "I don't mean for you to spend this dollar. I want you to keep this dollar bill to remind you of those who don't have very much, who aren't as lucky as we are. Let this be a reminder to you, my son." That was Doy's mom in a magical moment at Bangkok Airport. Curtain down.
Thank you. Okay.
Connect to you. You don't know who's sitting next to you. Connect to your partner. Get to know each other for a few minutes. Share leadership moments. And the joy is we get to hear a few of these before we wrap it up. So enjoy what we call, in the words of Nelson Mandela, another hero of mine, the triumph of the human spirit. Enjoy it. Speak. Okay, first of all, the first thing you want to do is thank your partner. And it's very, very abbreviated. Thank your partner. Okay. How were How were the conversations?
Good.
Excellent.
Genuine.
Okay.
Personal.
Genuine, personal. So you see, when you just stop long enough for a moment and focus, and you talk about what has heart and meaning, you know, share a leadership moment. This is how I became the leader I became. And it's unbelievable how suddenly there's substance in that moment. So we're going to just have time to hear a couple of these. Could you two guys come up here and let's give them a hand? Good, okay, great. And so if you can just, one of you bring the curtain up, deep and brief, and let's all, one of the things we teach also in leadership communications, show up and choose to be present. So if you can really just show up here, the anthropological principle that we really show up for each other, we honor each other in a team meeting at all times to really show up for these guys. And so it's
Mitch.
Mitch, so when Mitch brings the curtain up, we're all there for him. Take it away. Go, baby. Go for it. Great. Woo!
So open the door to the Grand Colorado Hotel. As I just checked in my parents, I just graduated from college and I had my first job, and I was so proud to take my parents out, especially my father, who I knew coming to this place and getting to see his son sort of take the leadership and take them out and do a whole trip around them. And particularly that hotel had roots with the railway and train, which was very important to my father because his grandfather took a boat all the way to New York, then from there took a train all the way just past Colorado, and then went by muleback and wagon to Berkeley and graduated in 1892 from the engineering school. So it was a big deal when the youngest son got to come to Berkeley, and so that's why I got a big round of applause from my dad was not around to see me graduate from graduate school. But that trip was monumental for me because it was the first time I took responsibility and planned this all out. And the smile on my dad's face when he was in that presidential suite, he felt like the man. And so it was just a treat, and that's. I guess it always stuck with me, and since he passed away a couple years later, it's like the memory is still pretty vivid and carries me a lot. And that's it.
Great.
Toby's gonna like this one. Is this on? Whatever.
Bring the curtain up.
October 2005. My mom and I are sitting in the stands. The White Sox are in the World Series. It's been ages. They've never won as long as she's been alive, as long as her grandfather's been alive. And I'm there, game two, grand slam, walk-off homer. My mom turns to me and says, "This is the happiest night after the birth of my children." And actually what had happened over the course of those few weeks, we happened to all be in Chicago. A lot of us don't live there anymore, but everyone was around. Everyone was, you know, getting so excited about it, but at the same time, everyone was together and going through this moment and able to reflect on it afterward. And that moment of all the sort of memories of family, both of my mother and my entire sort of family, it always sort of stands out as that central point. And sort of as we go on through the years, we're scattered about the globe. But sort of the opportunity to be together and to enjoy things together and what it meant to rally around each other is something that sort of in life and working on teams, you know, you relish those opportunities that are also very few to get people together and really accomplish great things. So not that we were part of the reason the White Sox won the World Series, but we were there, we experienced the joy, and it always sort of stuck with me as a memory to carry forward.
Great, thank you so much. Thank you so much. Okay, so you're going to tell
Kate.
you'll tell Kate's story, and you'll tell, so Peter, can you tell Kate's story?
Sure.
Okay, so up here, and you're here. So you're gonna honor Kate, and then Kate, you're gonna honor Peter, and keep it to 60 seconds. Show up and be present, ready, take it away. You can do it. We love those shoes.
Up. Woo! Kate, 2 years ago, Kate made some monumental decisions in her life, all of which for the better. She and her husband moved to Madison, Wisconsin, and started to embark on new chapters in their lives. He started pursuing some important aspects in his career to bring stability. And the driving force behind getting that stability has been has come recently to bear great fruit for Kate. So Kate has recently decided to leave her job, where she was on a very, very fast track to great success, in order to pursue parts of her life that she wanted, that she felt had gone unexplored previously. And she wasn't able to until they moved to a different part of the country to get stability in their family. And then she's done, once she left her current, her old company, she decided to go out and start two different companies simultaneously. So for me, it's been a great lesson in perseverance to understand kind of where you want to get to and put in the building blocks along the way to work with your partners and work with your friends to get where you want to be. And then having the incredible courage to actually follow through on that. Right, to say I'm going to step away from a career that's going really, really well and could go a lot further because I want to pursue some other stuff that has more value to me in my life.
Bring that curtain down. Great. Good. And bring the curtain up 60 seconds and honor Peter with his story. Take it away.
All right.
You're doing fine.
So Peter's sister-in-law had her identity stolen. She got a flashing notice from her bank account one day that said, basically, you have no more money. And she had no idea why. I don't actually know when this happened, but it happened recently enough that it's actually influenced the course of Peter's career. So he was recently at a startup. He chose to leave and join a company called LifeLock, which is going to help all of us protect our identities. So this is a monumental kind of, I think, moment in Peter's life that helped him make a choice to step into a growing industry, something that helps people and protects people, has some really hard, interesting technical challenges involved in it, and also lets him be here with his 6-year-old and 9-year-old and wife. And that's about as far as we got into his story.
That's great. Bring it down. And acknowledge each other. Acknowledge each other. Come on. Two lovely, lovely ladies here. Here we go. Great. And you'll honor her and you honor her. Okay, deep and brief, short. Huh? Yeah, not nice and short. Give them a hand, they need some confidence. Woo! Hey! Woo! Everybody, we support everybody. That's the whole deal. There's no judgment here. Great.
Imagine India, heat, all colors, 1992. And then a few hours later, Chicago, cold, winter in high school.
Wow.
That's the story of my friend. She told it. Coming at 14 years old in Chicago high school, where she doesn't know anything about clique, society, rules, English with the British accent. So she stands out. And her family comes with all the luggages and all the nuances. 14-year-old girl in India who just knew how to be happy, singing song. In Chicago, she becomes translator, she becomes administrator, she becomes person how to find where and how soon. So she felt she needs to grow up within a month from little innocent girl into person who has to be responsible for her mother, father, and her family. Mm. Many, many years later, comes to the school, and then she realized that she didn't need leadership management. She was leader at age 14. Huh. Meet her.
Wonderful! Yeah. Great! Excellent! Excellent! Great! Bravo! Lovely! Yeah. Somebody with the mic.
Well, imagine Mongolia,
yeah.
And a place that we still don't know enough about.
Yeah.
People still question about it. And you find a young girl going to a school under a very different system where she's sticking out and not really welcomed by a lot of children around her who are a lot more privileged. So she's made to feel that. And as life continues on, she finds a way to create her own path despite never fitting in anywhere, and goes to pursue an amazing career in biotech, graduates from schools in Europe, lives in America, creates a family with an amazing man, has two boys, and is truly an inspirational leader in just so many ways. And something she said will always stay with me is, don't just be a leader at workplace, be this leader at home. It starts in your home, who you are, and who do you choose to be around your family and your kids? And that's where it should be. Your source of inspiration needs to come from there. So.
And acknowledge each other. Acknowledge each other. Beautiful. Okay. Thank you both.
Beautiful.
We're at the end. I wish we weren't. I mean, look at all this wonderful, 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 wonderful work. And I want to thank you. All of you who came up, and I want to thank all of you for coming. I mean, such beautiful, beautiful stories, and such honoring. And I'm just going to just close very, very briefly something that you just said now, one of the lessons in leadership communications, which I'm going to now say, you can find Doy and I there. You want to drop in and sit in on the class? I invite you as our guest. You're alum, you come in, join in, behave yourself, and come in and you guys join in. You are our honored guests. Why not? You're all part of the family. But one of the lessons that actually goes on there is very much something you just retaught us. We ask people between the weeks, what are you leaving at home that you need to be bringing to work? What are you leaving at home that you need to be bringing to work? And what are you leaving at work that needs to come home? In other words, we're one being. And that maybe you're forgetting the grace that needs to come to work. Maybe at work there's a kind of structure that needs to come back home so that there's not so much chaos. We can learn from the workplace. We can learn from the home. We can learn from all these wonderful, wonderful, wonderful things. And I'm going to just close, first of all, thanking you very, very much for being such a wonderful, wonderful audience. Doy, do you have any final words before I do my favorite reading?
Make the most of your time here. And already within this room, there's a lot that you can learn just by sharing stories. So enjoy your time here and make the most of it.
Thank you so, so much. And let's give him a big, big hand. I had the great honor of meeting many, many very, very noted people in my life. And the most thrilling moment for me was meeting Nelson Mandela and being there for his inauguration. My wife is a documentary filmmaker. And interestingly enough, back to the President Clinton story, when we were interviewing noted people during Mandela's time, and she asked President Clinton, who was Nelson Mandela to you? He said, I could say fellow president, I could say personal friend. But actually, Nelson Mandela is my spiritual teacher because he taught me not to hate. He taught me not to hate. And when Mr. Mandela came out of prison after 27 years, prison, Robben Island, and all of that, you know, he came out on the steps of Cape Town and he said, "I come to you as your humble servant. And please don't hate one another. There's no time for that. We have to build a new nation." And at his inauguration, he spoke these words, which I want to dedicate to you, from Marianne Williamson's A Return to Love. So a dedication as you go on your way through the alumni conference and into your journeys here and far. And he said, on that May 1994 day, he said, "Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant, gorgeous, talented, and fabulous? Actually, who are you not to be? Your plain small doesn't serve the world. There's nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people won't feel insecure around you. We are all meant to shine as children do. We are all meant to shine as children do. And we were born to make manifest the glory of God that's within us. It's not just in some of us, it's actually in everyone. As we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. As we're liberated from our own fear, as we're liberated from our own fear, our presence automatically liberates others." Spoken by a humble man, May 1994, as he strove with all of his might to give birth to a new nation. Which he so did. So I want to thank you for being a wonderful audience. I hope it puts some vitality into your day. And with that, let's all bring the curtain down. Thank you so much.